Good morning. Welcome to First Presbyterian Church. Thank you so much for being here. I know it's hot. I know it's the, normally this time of year we're starting to think about the fair. It's getting rain. It's getting cool. We kind of get that first taste of fall. And I feel like this year we're all 2 or 3 weeks behind on the weather at least, if not other things too. And I feel like we're getting some of that nice hot weather. I'm sure lots of people are out enjoying vacation times, things like that. So if you are, God bless you. Hope to see you again soon. Speaking of vacation, Marta leaves on vacation Tuesday, and I leave on vacation tomorrow. But we have some wonderful volunteers that are going to be helping out in the front office. And we also have a temporary worker that's going to be here with us, who's returning, I believe. So things are still, the office will still be open, normal hours, things like that. If you have any questions, please call or email us. But we'll all be back in about a week or two. Marta's gets back in about 2.5 weeks. So if you have questions about that, just come find me after service. Are there any other announcements? I believe Dave Dreidoppel, our clerk of session, has a report on the session meeting from last Tuesday.
Good morning. I'm sorry I didn't print it out, so it's just on my phone. Session met, and we conducted the normal business that we conduct every month. Started out with a devotion and prayer. Agenda was approved. We spent time in prayer for our church, for our city, our nation, bringing specific prayers for those who were there as they provided prayer requests. Minutes were approved. Vital statistics were approved. Session spent a good amount of time on the session covenant, an agreement between ourselves and our pastor and our congregation on how we will be conducting business going forward. The covenant is something that we've had for a number of years, and it was time to review it, update it, and approve it again. There was a little bit of time that we discussed a new church directory and how we'll be gathering updated addresses and names for the congregation. Did that for a little bit. We had ministry team reports were received and discussed. We talked about the possibility of increasing hours for children's ministry director. That was forwarded to the personnel committee for a recommendation. And a couple, there are some changes with the new elders in attendance. Some updated things for the financial end of it. People who will be counting offerings, people who will be signing checks, those had to be changed over between the old section and the new section, that session that was in attendance last night, the new session members. And so a number of those were approved to be signers and to count money. And finally, one of the things we have to do is elect a new president and vice president of the corporation, and those were elected with Elder Paul Reichert being elected as corporate president and Brian Rosell elected as the vice president of the corporation. And that was about the business we conducted. It was a time of transferring from elders who were going off session and new elders coming on session.
Thank you, Dave. Yeah. Thanks to all of our elders for all their work. We're very excited to have this kind of new class, new season of our church and church leadership, and would ask that you continue to pray for all of us as we seek to discern the mind of Christ for First Presbyterian Church moving forward for the next year and years to come. Any other announcements? Please stand for the call to worship.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, how excellent is your greatness. You are clothed with majesty and splendor. You send the springs into the valleys. They flow between the mountains. All the beasts of the field drink their fill from them, and the wild donkeys quench their thirst. Beside them, the birds of the air make their nests and sing among the branches. In all we say, please give us grace to voice creation's praise. Please remain standing as we sing.
Savior, like a shepherd, lead us. Much we need thy tender care. In thy pleasant pastures, feed us. For our use, thy faults repair. Blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are. Blessed Jesus, thou hast bought us, thine we are. We are thine, do thou befriend us, be the guardian of our way. Keep thy flock from sin, defend us, seek us when we go astray. Blessed Jesus, hear, O hear us when we pray. Blessed Jesus, hear, O hear us when we pray. Thou hast promised to receive us, poor and sinful though we be. Mercy to relieve us, grace to cleanse and power to free. Blessed Jesus, early let us turn to thee. Blessed Jesus, early turn. Seek thy favor, early let us do thy will. Blessed Lord and only Savior, with thy love our beings fill. Blessed Jesus, thou hast loved us, love us still. Blessed Jesus, thou hast loved us, love us still. Oh,
Please join me in confessing our common sin. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have sinned through my own fault, in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have left undo. And I ask you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. Let us take a silent moment to confess our personal sin. Hear the good news. Jesus Christ came into our world to save sinners. He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross, that we might be dead to sin, but alive to all that is good. I declare to you, in the name of Christ Jesus, that you are forgiven. Sing.
Light of the world, you step down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see. Beauty that made this heart adore you. Hope of a life spent with you. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow.
Joy it is to be here with all of you today, my brothers and sisters in Christ, worshiping the Lord. And it is also my great joy to see my child pursuing the Lord. And so I will try not to embarrass her too much, but I just have such great joy today. And I just pray that you too will experience joy and peace here in this place today, just because we are here. We are alive and breathing, and God has brought us here. And so I pray the peace of Christ would be with you. Turn and give the peace of Christ to your neighbors.
I feel like we could get away with just letting this happen for 40 minutes and then going home, but we should probably keep doing the worship service. There's so much to be grateful for, so many wonderful, friendly faces to greet, to share the peace of Christ with. But for now, let's continue to worship by presenting our tithes and offerings to God.
please stand. Lord God, we praise you, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. We give you thanks for every good gift, for the rain, for the sun, for the grass beneath our feet. God, we recognize that every good gift comes from you, and that also there is still need in this world. There are hungry people, there are people who have not yet heard your good news. And so, God, we offer these gifts up as signs of our gratitude, signs of your abundance, signs of your mission, that we are saying yes to go out into the world, to share what you have given us, so that all might come to know the saving name of Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. How can we be sharing what God is up to in our lives? How can we be coming together to pray for one another? If you have something to share, I would ask that you raise your hand and I will come by with a microphone. Just the Teds today.
Last week, Joan had a request prayer for her nephew and niece, who is struggling with cancer, and they were going to Maui, and she's on a very serious, unusual cancer that's requiring a lot of special treatment. But they were able to leave and go to Maui for the wedding. And they had the wedding yesterday on the beach at Maui, and everything went really well. She's very frail, and she still needs a lot of prayer. Courtney, she still needs a lot of prayer, but it's an answer to prayer. They were so hoping they'd be able to make the trip and find a time. And though they originally wanted to stay several days, the doctor only allowed about a 4-day window there and a lot of travel. She's very frail. Just continue to remember in prayer.
God, we lift up Courtney, and we celebrate with Courtney and her groom, her husband, and with Joan and the whole family, God, that this could happen, that that you could provide the way to have this dream wedding. And God, we pray for Courtney. We ask for your presence, for your strength, for your healing. That not only could she give thanks for this day, but for each day to come. God, may your peace and your presence reign in her and her husband's hearts. And God, we continue to ask for a miracle, for healing, for complete healing and restoration for Courtney as well. In Jesus' name, amen. Other folks, let's see.
I'm Larry Evers. My wife, Elva, and I were here 10 years ago, and we spent a year with you then. Really enjoyed worshiping here with you. And many faces I remember, and many I don't as I look around here. But I'm very glad to have had you as a part of my spiritual history, and may God bless you richly. Thank you.
Welcome back, Larry and Ellen. Elva, excuse me. Larry and Elva, it's good to see you again. God, we give you thanks for Larry and Elva and for blessed reunions of all kinds. Amen.
When Rick got out of the car this morning here, his back popped. So I'd like prayers for his back so it won't hurt so much.
Okay. God, we pray for Rick. So many of us have experienced a little bit of back pain or joint pain. We know what that feels like, and we don't want that for ourselves or for Rick. God, I ask that you would be healing Rick mightily, giving him strength, giving him an end to any pain or discomfort or stiffness.
God, that you would be aligning the muscles and the tendons and the bones in Rick's back, that he might have just full mobility, full strength, no pain. God, we pray for Rick and his back right now in your name, Jesus. Amen.
Hello. So my dad on May 15th had a seizure that led to a heart attack, that led to a big stroke, that led to tiny other strokes all at once. And I'm just so lucky that God had my back, and my shower went cold because I came out and I found him on the floor. And this was about a month ago, and now he can talk. And he has the IQ level of like a fourth grader though currently. So, but yeah, I don't really know what to say. Yeah. Robert Siebels.
Yeah. God, we give you thanks that Katie's dad Robert is recovering, is doing so much better, that he's breathing on his own after a massive heart attack and stroke and further complications from that. God, we know that this is an answered prayer. God, we pray for continued recovery for Robert, that he would grow in his capacity, in his mind, in his brain, in his heart, in his whole body. And God, we ask that you would be with Katie and Robert's whole family as they continue to care for him, as they pray for him, as they love and enjoy every minute they have with him, God. Again, we ask for your presence, for your peace, for your power, God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Yes, good morning, church. I just want to invite you to join me in thanking God for our wonderful community here. So many people have come up to me over the past months asking if my wife is okay and have been praying for us. So I'll just make a public declaration. She does have her green card. Yes. And she is here with us at home, and our daughter is together with her. We're settling into the community very nicely. Our daughter is enjoying vacation Bible schools throughout this community, and we're making new friends. So this really is a lovely place to be, and I thank God for us being here for this past year.
What's your wife's first name?
Oh, her name is Shizuka.
Shizuka. Shizuka. Okay. God, we give you thanks. We give you thanks that Shizuka was able to complete this green card process, that she is securely here with her husband, with her daughter. What a wonderful thing that is to know that is a settled matter. And so, God, we give you thanks that they are here, that they're a part of Fairbanks, they're a part of First Pres. And, God, we ask for more more blessing, opportunities to now not only feel like they're a part of the community, but that they can really reach out and join in the activities and the work of the church and in all the good things that come from being a resident, being here and connected. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Anyone else? Let's see.
Along with the particular joy of having loved ones follow the Lord is the sorrow of those who are struggling in their relationship with the Lord. So just prayers for family members, loved ones who are not following the Lord or struggling to just understand his ways.
God, life is complicated, and it's very difficult and painful sometimes. And a lot of times we can see the imperfections in a broken world. We can see the our own hurts caused by other people, sometimes other people in the church. And that can lead to doubting you or doubting your purposes for us. And God, I pray for people that are struggling in that way right now. God, I ask that you would hold them close. I ask that you would comfort them even in the midst of their doubts. I ask that you would be providing God, it's easy to say, and it's hard to experience, hard to truly wrap our heads around it. But for all of our questions, the greatest answer you ever give us is yourself. And so, God, I pray that that would be happening for people who are doubting or struggling or walking away from their faith. That rather than being given an easy answer or a new worldview, that you would be giving them you. You would be giving them yourself and Jesus. That they might come to a deeper understanding of you, a deeper understanding of the world, a deeper understanding of your love for them and for the world too. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for coming to us, even in our doubts, even in our pain. We ask that now for those who are struggling. Amen.
Yeah. You know, I think I told you guys before, I had money problems. I spent 2 or 3 weeks cleaning up the yard. I moved to my house after the other house I had got repossessed in 2015, and I put my folks' stuff in boxes, and when I moved in November of 2015, so I put everything I had in boxes, and that's where most of it went. I put it outside last year so I could tape and texture an addition on my house, and this summer I wanted to finish the addition. Yeah, but I cleaned up the yard for 2 weeks, and then most of the stuff was in boxes. It was no more good, so most of it went to the dump. And then I was going to start working on my boat, but I had numerous roof leaks when it started raining, and I'd go to the store and buy 5-gallon buckets of rain patch and put it on the roof, and then I'd think I had it fixed, and then it would rain some more and I'd find more leaks. So I spent probably the last 10 days trying to get the leak seal. Hopefully I got them all. I put a hose up there and I was trying to test, make sure it is, but I'm not sure I got them all yet. And I'm still planning to retake the journeyman test to try to pay the big tax bill I got, but I took it twice. And I missed by 2 points one and 3 points the other. So just prayers that I pass the test and I'm able to get a job to pay for the it was taxes on money that I did not get. And I don't understand why I have to pay taxes on, because I didn't receive the money, but yeah. They don't seem to, it doesn't work like that.
God, we pray for Walter. We ask that you'd be making a path forward, that you'd be giving him the presence of mind and ability to focus to pass this test, this journeyman's test, as he said. And God, we ask you'd be giving him your presence, your peace. He's had to say goodbye to some folks. He's had to say goodbye to some beloved belongings that he inherited from his parents. God, there's a lot of grief. And we ask that you'd be with Walter, helping him through that time, through that this tough period, that you'd be making a way forward, that you'd be allowing him to tackle these things in front of him. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's close the way we always close. Say that prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, that we are remembering and try to pray every day as well. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I'd like to invite all the kids to come forward for a kid's sermon with Miss Karina.
Well, hi. Welcome up here. Today, Pastor David is going to be talking about parties. And so I thought that we could talk about parties too. Let's brainstorm together. What might be the best party ever? What would you need at the best party ever? Yeah, Holly? A pool. Yes, good start. What else do we need at the best party ever? What do you like to see? Oh, Sawyer's got an idea. Balloons. Excellent. What do you think, Juniper? Cake. Yeah, really big cake. Nora, what do we need at a party? Can you help me? Balloons, presents, and pools. Thank you, Auntie. Good job, Nora. What else do we need at a party? Do you like to have food at your parties? Oh, you have an idea. What's your idea? Oh, people. Yes, that's important. It's not really a party without people. Good thinking. What kind of foods would you like at a party? I have this like little sticker sheet here. Let's see. I'll read some and you tell me if these are on there. Would we have hamburgers? Maybe. Bacon? Would there be bacon at our party? Donuts. Oh, yeah, we'd have votes for donuts. Ice cream? Ice cream, okay. How about pizza? Okay, approved. Pretzels, big soft pretzels. Okay, yes. French fries? What if we had pancakes at our pool party? Is anybody for that? Yeah, okay. This is looking like a really, oh, and here's one. Should we have tacos at our party? Yay! All right, those are some good. Is there anything that wasn't on that list that you want to include? Yeah. Veggie sticks. I like veggies too. That could be really good. What else do we have, Juniper? Chips. Mmm. Yes, Nora? What should we have? Cake. Yes, don't forget the cake. What kind of cake should we have? Big or small? Big. Big. We have votes for big. If we were going to have a party, we would have all those things. Let's see. I think I might add like a petting zoo, some animals to pet, a bounce house, a trapeze. Lots of fun things we could do. Well, what can ruin a party? What's something that ruins a party? Yeah. You thought, it's okay. What ruins a party? Nora knows something. What ruins a party, Nora? You want to think about it? Okay. What ruins a party, Juniper? Thieves. Yes, that would ruin a party. Someone came in and stole the cake. Sawyer, what ruins a party? Bad weather, a wind that would blow away all the fun stuff. Yeah. What else? Rain. Maybe it would ruin it. It would soften the cake. That's right. She's smart. Yes, Holly? Thunder. Yeah, that might be scary. Might scare the animals, might scare us. Well, God says that he is going to throw a party to celebrate that he has beaten the party wrecker, the worst party wrecker ever. Have you ever, can you guess who the worst party wrecker ever would be?
My brothers.
No, I don't think it's your brothers.
I don't think so.
When I think of the worst party wrecker ever, I think of the one who makes people be mean to each other. The one who breaks things and breaks plans and hurts people. And that would be Satan. That would be the enemy of God. And he is in charge of death and dying and bad things happening of all kinds. God wants to throw a party to say, I have beaten that guy. And we're never going to have parties wrecked again. Nobody is going to cry anymore. Nobody's going to die anymore. Nobody's going to fall and scrape their knee anymore. there's always going to be enough for everyone. There's not going to be bad weather unless we want some really fun big weather. Yeah, you fell and scraped your knee. At God's party, there's not going to be any more hurts. Yes, Sawyer? Except you kind of like rain. I kind of like rain, too. See, if we want some weather, we can have that. But at God's party, only good things are happening because the party wrecker has been defeated and death has been beaten. Now, do you think that sounds like a good party? Would you like to go to a party like that where nobody gets hurt? There's tons of food. There's lots of fun things to do. Nope, you know. Does it sound like a good party? Cotton candy rain, that would be cool too. Sounds like kind of a good party. You like cotton candy? Or you don't like? Well, options. This is a real party that God is going to throw someday. This is a real party. And the thing is that Pastor David is going to remind us is that everyone is invited. And the only reason you don't come is because you don't want to come. Some people don't want to be around Jesus and don't want to be at his party. And they show that by what they do. They're mean to people. They say, Jesus, I have no interest in you. I don't want to read the Bible. But you guys get to decide if you want to come to the party. You just have to tell Jesus. Jesus, someday I want to be at the party. You can tell him with your words and your prayers. And you can tell him by what you do. You can tell him by being nice to brothers. And you can tell him by being kind to your parents. And you can tell him by learning more and more and more about him and reading the Bible. Nora, you have an idea? Maybe later. It's okay. You have good ideas. You can tell me later. You want to come? Awesome. All you have to do is tell Jesus and act like you want to be there. That's all you have to do. Let's pray right now so that we can talk to Jesus like we need to. All right? Jesus, thank you for all these kids. And I pray that you would teach them how to speak to you from their hearts, that you would help them to have a picture in their head of this amazing party you want them to be part of, and that they would know they're welcome and they're loved. And you would so like for them to be with you forever. We ask that you would help them to show that they want to be with you by learning and by being kind. Lord, we thank you that everyone is invited, and would you help us to tell everybody that they're invited? Nobody is supposed to be left out. We pray all these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. I have something for you before you go back to seats. There. Two things, actually. If you want to make a cake drawing of the best cake you can think of, you can take one of those. And if you want a sticker to remind you of a fun, fun party that you're invited to, you can take one of those. There you go. There you go. You are invited, and all of your friends. There you go. Give them stickers right here. There you go. All right. Back we go.
I don't know if many of y'all heard it, because it's kind of one of the blessings of being in the front row is you get to hear all the fun kids' responses to Karina's questions. But they were talking about the party, and then somebody said, rain, and then Juniper said, but the rain will make the cake softer. And that's just the most Alaskan, adaptive, go with the flow, you know, no problem. It's raining, but now the cake is softer. I love that attitude, that willingness to just roll with the punches and see the bright side. Thank you for that wonderful reminder, Juniper. Our first reading today is from the prophet Isaiah, the 25th chapter, beginning at verse 6. Isaiah said, on this mountain, the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, rich food full of marrow, aged wine well-refined. God will swallow up on this mountain the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from every face, and the reproach of his people he will take away from all of the earth. For the Lord has spoken.
It will be said on that day, "Behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation." Our gospel reading today is from the Gospel of Luke, the 14th chapter, beginning at verse 15. When one of those who reclined at the table with Jesus heard these things, he said to him, "Blessed is everyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God." But Jesus said to him, "A man once gave a great banquet and invited many, many people. And at the time for the banquet, he sent his servant to say to those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is now ready.' But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said to him, 'I have bought a field. I must go out and see it. Please have me excused.' Another said, 'I have bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I must go to examine them. Please have me excused.' And another said, 'I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come.' So the servant came and reported these things to his master. Then the master of the house became angry and said to his servant, 'Go out quickly to the streets and the lanes of the city. Bring in the poor, the paralyzed, the blind, and the lame.' The servant said, 'Sir, what you have commanded has been done. There's still more room.' And the master said to the servant, 'Go out to the highways and the hedges. Compel people to come in so that my house may be filled. For I tell you, none of those men who are invited shall taste my banquet.' This is the word of God." How many of y'all have a favorite story, kind of a family story that, you know, every time you tell it, something gets a little added on? Maybe it's a fishing story, maybe it's a hunting story, maybe it's a road trip. Raise your hand if you've got one of those in your family. Does the same person always tell it? Is it always mom, or is it always dad? Or does mom try to tell it, and then dad interrupts halfway through? Says, no, this is how it really happened. We all have stories like that. We all have great stories. Great stories that bring us together, that honestly kind of become a family heirloom. They help define what it means to be a Smith, or a McConnell-Booher, or a Roselle, right? There are these stories that we have that we share with people when they come into our homes, or that we share with people over a cup of coffee when we're trying to tell them a little bit about our lives, who we are, what we do. Stories shape us. Stories help define us. Stories give us insight into other people's lives, into how they view the world, how they have interacted with the world. Today we're talking about stories. The stories that Jesus tells as parables. But I realize, as we've gone down this sermon series, and you've got that handy-dandy guide there in your bulletin, we're just past the halfway mark now. And we're into the New Testament, and we don't have a Christmas episode in this sermon series. It's kind of weird. We went straight from prophets and prophets on God's mission right into Jesus' parables, and next week we're talking about Jesus' miracles. Paul Reichardt's going to be giving that sermon, and I got to tell you, I'm a little bummed I'm going to be missing it. It's one of the downsides of vacation, is you find a great guest preacher, and then you don't get to hear them preach it live. But we don't have a Christmas episode. We're not talking about Jesus' birth, his arrival, though that is certainly something worth talking about. Suffice to say, this entire sermon series, from the very beginning at Genesis 1:1 to the very end of Revelation and everything in between, is about Jesus. And Jesus is about all of this. And that is because a lot of everything we're talking about is God's purpose for us. God's purpose for us, as we've seen, is for us to be created, right? To give us life, to give us a role in creation as stewards, as co-creators with God, as people who are not only filled with the breath of God in the sense that we pump oxygen in and carbon dioxide out, but also in the sense that we have the breath of God in us so that we can do things in creative and wonderful ways that connect us to God and connect other people to God, because it says right there in Genesis that we are made in the image of God. In the image of God, we are created male and female, and that that means that there is something special, something that God has put in us and on us so that we might join in God's purpose, not only for creation, but also for life and inspiration and restoration. Right, we see this continue through with the covenants, the promises that God makes with Abraham, that he will be blessed, yes, but that he will be blessed to be a blessing. And we see that continue through Moses and the people of God in the wilderness as they're taught what it means to be God's people and not to be like the Egyptians, not to hold slaves, not to hold debts and great earthly things over one another, to have kind of, you know, the kings and then the lords and then the peasants and then the slaves, right? God is kind of deconstructing that way of thinking with the law, with the commandments, teaching people how to live in a way that is loving and caring and respectful and upholds peace and justice in community. This is all part of God's purpose and God's mission. Right? And we can jump forward. We talked about Judges and Kings and Prophets. The point of all of that was to show the ways in which certain people of God were inspired and were following God, at least some of the time, but other people neglected that purpose, neglected that mission. Jonah was the best example. Jonah was of Abraham, of Israel, was blessed to be a blessing, not just as a Jewish person, but as a prophet. And when God said, go, he said, no, thank you, God, right? And turned away not only from Nineveh, the direction God was sending him, but also was explicitly rejecting this purpose, this mission to go, to bless others, to restore some bit of creation back to the Creator. So when we talk about Jesus, we're talking about God truly fulfilling every promise that he has made. Pastor Peter talked about that in Advent and around Christmas this last year, that Jesus is the fulfillment of countless prophecies in the Old Testament. And we see one right here in Isaiah chapter 5. Isaiah chapter 5, verse 6 through 9, talks about this feast that brings all nations to the mountain of the Lord. This grand wedding celebration in which every nation is invited, in which the veil of sin, the shroud of death is pulled away, and all people are living in the way that God always wanted them to be, both in communion and in right relationship with him and with each other. This is the fulfillment of God's mission. So when Jesus comes into the world, he is eager to share everything that God has for us. And he does that in a number of ways. And in the first way is parables. And so we come to our first truth, right? The truth you might not know. Our first biblical truth today is that parables are not mere fables. They're not like Aesop's fables where there's a single moral lesson that we can take away, like the tortoise and the hare. Slow and steady wins the race, right? Jesus does not tell parables so that we can be a little bit more ethical, a little bit more virtuous. Jesus tells parables to give people a chance to see the world or to see God in a better light, from a better vantage point. Jesus tells parables, and there's a fantastic book. I cannot recommend it highly enough. I left it in my office. I apologize. But it's by a man named Kenneth Bailey, and it's called Jesus Through Middle Eastern Eyes. And it's a fantastic look not only at the parables, but at many things about Jesus, his life, his ministry, in the context of the ancient Near East, of Jerusalem and Palestine in that first century. And so he breaks down a lot of things that might still be true in the Middle East today that are not like culturally contextual for us that are found in Scripture, as well as a number of other wonderful, rich historical things. But Ken Bailey describes Jesus' parables as houses. They're not fables with a single kind of arrow of a moral lecture or a lesson. They are houses that Jesus builds that he invites people to come and sit in, to experience the warmth and the hospitality of the home, and then to stand up and look out the window of the house and to see the world in a different light. And so when we talk about parables, we're not trying to boil it down and find the most essential oil of the truth, right? When we're talking about parables, we're looking to see the world kind of the way Jesus sees the world. And in this story, there are some things that we can miss out if we read it too quickly, or if we don't take the time to understand the different context and try to find some cultural notes that connect with us. The first thing you should know is that this parable, this story of a grand banquet feast that Jesus tells here in Luke 14, is a direct connection to what we read in Isaiah 25. The Isaiah prophecies were well known to Jesus, to the Pharisees, the Sadducees. All the characters in the Gospels knew this story, knew this prophecy. In fact, it was a hotly debated prophecy. Ken Bailey talks about this in his book and says there is a version of Isaiah in a kind of a collection of scripture that also included commentary called the Targum. I know we're getting a little scholarly, we're getting a little nerdy today, but follow this with me for just a moment longer. In the Targum, Isaiah 25, 6 through 9 is edited so severely that instead of God welcoming all nations, all peoples, all tongues and tribes to this mountain for a grand banquet feast, almost all the other nations are actually condemned or destroyed by God rather than welcomed to the table. Let that sink in for a moment, right? That was the prevailing understanding, the prevailing cultural view at the time. Now, you have to keep in mind, we talked about this a few times when we talked about Judges and Kings. Israel, the Jewish people at this point, have been conquered four or five times over. All right, Egyptians, Assyrians, Babylonians, Persians, Greeks, and Romans. All of them have been empires that have included that little corner of the Mediterranean that we know as Israel and Palestine, that was the Jewish nation, the Jewish homeland, Canaan, the land of milk and honey. And so for the Jewish people living up before Jesus' time and into Jesus' time, the idea of God blessing, loving, redeeming, welcoming at the end of time all the other nations, when in their mind, almost all the other nations have been brutally violent and oppressive to them, it was too hard a pill to swallow. And so a lot of the rabbis, a lot of the scholars and scribes of Scripture were taking things that God had promised through prophets like Isaiah and were changing them a little bit, at least in their commentaries, at least in certain versions of the prophets. It's not to say that they were rewriting Scripture everywhere, but that in these versions, you could see that woundedness, that anger, that hurt come through. So that's the first cultural context. The second is that Jesus is, of course, already at a banquet. And this banquet is not one that he is hosting. It's not one that he has in any way helped, you know, put together the guest list. This is a relatively wealthy and prestigious person who has invited Jesus because Jesus is now a famous rabbi, teacher, and miracle worker. So Jesus and whichever disciples were allowed to come with Jesus are by far very likely to be the least well-dressed, probably the stinkiest people at the table, probably the people with the worst manners at this banquet, okay? And Jesus had just kind of told what was more of a fable type parable just before this, what was more of a just kind of a quick moral lesson on how to be polite, but it did still have the emphasis on humility. And now this person, this other person at the table is saying, "Blessed be the one who eats bread in the kingdom of God," which is itself kind of referencing that promise of this feast at the end of time that God will host in his kingdom. And so Jesus tells us a parable that is directly pointed at people who most likely had been reading Isaiah and maybe reading that rewritten version of Isaiah, saying the kingdom of God is going to be reserved for the people of God and everyone else can go to hell, right? That's basically what it's saying. So Jesus tells a parable. He says there was a wealthy man, powerful man, and he was hosting a great banquet and invited many, which means basically in the cultural context of the time that it was a done deal. These people had agreed to come, and it was now the time, and so it's a small town. You send your servant, your butler, out, and he says, everything has been prepared, right? The brisket is just right. Now's the time, right? And the first man, what does he say? I've bought a field, and I must go to inspect it. Please excuse me. I'm so sorry. I'm terribly sorry. I can't make it, but I've bought a field, and now I have to go look at it. Now, there's a little bit of cultural context here that we might not be picking up, but how many of you would buy any piece of property sight unseen and inspect it afterward? Raise your hand big and high. Okay. How many of you, if you're going to buy a piece of property, you would go and look at it first? Right. Okay. So we're catching on to something, right? Something is fishy in this man's excuse. He's still somewhat polite, but no one does this. And unless the man is particularly stupid, he didn't do this either. Okay? Second man, servant goes to the second household, says, come, for everything is now ready. I have bought 5 yoke of oxen. I must go and examine them. Okay? Similar idea. What are oxen? Anybody? Bulls. Yeah. They're bulls designed to pull. And what does a yoke mean? The thing on the shoulders that lets them pull. Okay? Here's the thing. Like a field, first of all, you go and look at it first before you buy it. That's obvious. But there's a deeper flaw here in this man's excuse. Oxen are worthless if they don't pull together as a pair. So he's bought 10 bulls here, 5 yoke, right? 5 yoke, 2 pairs. And if they don't pull together as a pair, that, like, you're basically eating that cost. Literally, you're going to have to eat those bulls because they're not worth anything else. It's like Joanne, I'm just going to call you out, right? You have this wonderful deal. You drop a lot of money on a pair of champion sled dogs, but you don't know what races they've ever run. You've never seen them run, but you just sent the money, and now you're saying, sorry, I can't come to your banquet that I said I'd come to because I got to go check out these dogs that I just paid a lot of money for, but I've never actually seen them run, right? You don't do it. This does not happen. So this is now twice in a row that they've said, please excuse me, but I have this completely made up excuse. I'm washing my hair. I can't come. Third person, even worse. The third person, first of all, you'll notice at the end, he does not say, please excuse me. He does not apologize. He does not make any kind of polite reference to anything. Just says, sorry. Doesn't say sorry, I guess. But he says something far cruder, okay? He says, I have a wife and I gotta go. And that's basically what he's saying. This is extremely vulgar. Everyone in Jesus' context would immediately know that this man is making a not very veiled reference to intercourse. And in a way that is public and is designed to basically shame the host of the banquet. And so now the 3 guests, all of whom had previously said that they would come, are now refusing to come, and they're all doing it with excuses that on the face of them are clearly either so ludicrous and stupid, but far more likely the fact that all 3 of them are doing it. This is designed to shame the host, to shame the man who invited them. So that gives us a little more insight into what Jesus is saying when he says, now the man goes out into the, says, send my servants into the streets, bring in everybody. I don't care what their deal is. I just want them here. I want them to enjoy the banquet because these people that have defied and insulted me will never enter my home again, is basically what he's saying. And Jesus is telling this story in the same vein as we've been talking about for the last couple weeks, as we've been talking about this entire time about the mission of God, Jesus is telling this story because the people who have been invited to the banquet are the people who have been entrusted with God's purpose, with God's mission, with God's blessing, and have repeatedly denied the invitation, defied God, insulted God, and walked away. These are the people who have led the people of God astray. These are the Pharisees and the Sadducees that Jesus is calling to the mat, right? Saying that you have made the people who follow you twice as fit for hell as you are yourselves. And seriously challenging the fact that God's mission was not to bless Israel and keep it right there and damn the enemies to hell. God's mission was to bless Israel so that all the world could know who God is, how God loves them. And Jesus is not condemning Israel. Jesus is not condemning the Jewish people. Jesus is condemning those who were trusted most with the mission and have walked away from it, spat in God's face. Our second truth today, the truth that you absolutely should know, you probably already know this, but we're going to say it again, is that Jesus' miracles, as Paul's going to talk about next week, and Jesus' parables, as we're talking about this week, are glimpses of the kingdom of God. A lot of times at communion, we talk about a foretaste of the feast to come. That feast, and again in Isaiah 25, as we are gathered around the mountain of God, as death has been eradicated, as every tear has been wiped away from every one of our faces, we get little peaks of that. We get a little taste on the tip of our tongue when we share in communion. When we hear the word of God in Jesus' parables, when we see the brokenness in our physical world restored in miraculous ways in Jesus' miracles. The parables and the miracles are glimpses of what everything restored will look like at the end of time. It is God's eternal kingdom breaking in, invading our world in tiny pinpricks of light in our reality. There are so many parables, and to be honest, I really struggled on picking which one to focus on for our sermon today. You go just a little bit further into Luke 15, and you have the parable of the lost sheep, the parable of the lost coin, the parable of the lost sons, usually called the prodigal son, but both sons are lost. These stories are powerful, powerful ideas, powerful houses in which the whole world looks different when we sit in that house and look out the window. Because those same people that Jesus is calling to the mat in our parable today are the ones who scoff when Jesus goes to the sinners, to the tax collectors, to the prostitutes, to the people that have never spent a day in synagogue, have never gone to church in their lives. Jesus is there with them, loving them, sharing stories with them, breaking bread with them, and they say, "How dare he?" And so Jesus says, "Which one of you, if you had 100 sheep and one was lost, would not leave the 99 safely behind to go and find that lost sheep? And when you found it, you would celebrate." Right? That is the kingdom of God. That is the mission of God. To seek and to save the lost, to bring everything that was broken and fallen after sin and to restore it, to bring it back into his love. God's parables, Jesus' parables, are glimpses of God's kingdom, proof of God's purpose in our world and in our life. We started off talking about stories. And I could tell you one story. Many of you have heard it before, but gosh, over 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago now, right after that terrible ice storm we had right after Christmas, I had to shoot a moose from the back of my dog sled. Had 8 dogs on my team. Joe, with 8 more dogs right behind me, were on the narrowest of trails, narrower than the gap between the pews and the wall right there by this far side of the church. And the moose were already hungry and aggressive, and it was an incredibly tense moment. And I could tell you all the details, and I'd be happy to. Suffice to say, it was harrowing, and it was scary. And I was so grateful that none of the dogs were hurt, that I myself wasn't hurt, that Joe wasn't hurt. And I regret that I had to shoot the moose, but it was him or us. And, talked with the troopers and worked it all out. It's exciting. It's a fun story to tell. But the best stories, the stories that Jesus tells and the stories that God calls us to tell, aren't just exciting. They're not just interesting because something exciting happened, because something was at stake. There was some kind of danger or risk involved. The best stories are the stories that point us to deeper meaning and purpose. The best stories are the ones like the ones that Jesus tells, because they give us a deeper understanding of God and who God is and how God loves us and what God is inviting us to do about it. That brings us to our third truth, our final truth for today, the truth that you can use. Jesus' parables teach us that we can use our own stories to invite others into God's kingdom. And just a month or so, I think it was in April, I preached a little bit about parables, and I invited y'all to come up with some parables of your own, to make some Alaskan parables. The kingdom of God, I think Paul said, the kingdom of God is like fireweed, because it comes after damage. It comes after destruction. It comes after the fire. And it is beautiful, and it is resilient, and it spreads faster than any other flower. Jesus used parables to point to the coming kingdom of God, to invite others to understand what it means to be a part of it, to literally invite people into the kingdom of God. And so our invitation is to hear those stories, yes, to read those stories again and again, to teach them to our children, but also to think about our own stories, to think about our own life, right? So many of Jesus' parables are about growing crops, about raising sheep and oxen, because that's what people did back then. Almost everybody had, at the very least, a garden where they grew some of their own food. What are the things that everyone does today? What are the things that connect us? What are the stories that we can tell that connect to the people we're telling them to and also connect them to God? So I want you to think about your stories. I want you to think about how God might be asking you to share your stories in a way that's, yes, compelling, that gets everybody leaning in a little bit to hear the end, but also invites people into God's kingdom. Because that's the greatest story we can tell. The stories that not only shape us as a family, shape us as a person, but also welcome people into the kingdom of God, that welcome and invite people to that feast at the end of time where Christ is the host of the table. We'll be doing that in 2 weeks together as a congregation, as a church family. Breaking bread, sharing the cup, hearing those words, this is the body of Christ broken for you. This is the blood that Jesus poured out for you, for the forgiveness of your sins and for the whole world. And we don't just do that because it's a ritual. We do that because it's God's story for us. God's story that it wasn't enough for us to be created, for us to fall to temptation and sin, and for us to be left in our sin to die. But Jesus comes to us full of stories, full of parables and miracles, giving himself so that we might have eternal life with God through him. So when I tell that moose story, I always end with the fact that before we even went out, Joe, Brenna, and I sat down and prayed. We asked for God's providence. We asked for safety. We asked for the right reactions to what may happen. We knew it was a treacherous trail and a treacherous time to be out on the sleds. And so we give thanks that God did protect us. We give thanks that there are opportunities to enjoy God's creation and that we still have those opportunities. We do our best to point back to God with our stories. And I would invite you to do the same. Would you please pray with me? Lord Jesus, we ask that you would continue to speak your word, that we could have the ears to hear and the eyes to see your kingdom, your eternal feast breaking into the midst of our world. And God, as we hear those stories and cling to them when we struggle, when we doubt, when we fear, when we hurt, God, may we be comforted. May we be reminded. May we have a deeper glimpse of your love for us, which is poured out at all times and in all places. And God, may we be so bold then to not only enjoy the feast, not only to keep that invitation, but to strike out into the world, to tell your stories, to tell our stories in ways that point to you and invite others to the table, invite others into your kingdom. And God, I ask that by your Holy Spirit, whatever is not from you may fall away, but that your word would remain, preserve, and keep us. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Please stand for our final song.
Sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show sky. Lord, I lift your name on. You came from heaven to earth to show the way, from the earth to the cross, my debt to pay, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord,
and now may the peace of Christ be with you wherever he is sending you. May Christ guide you through the wilderness and protect you through the storm. May Christ bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May Christ bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors. Go in peace.